mid-fall Sunday morning. And for those of you watching online, we also welcome you and pray that this service is meeting to you. If you have a need, please feel free to contact the church office, and we will do our best to accommodate your needs. And we do thank our veterans. I know we have at least one here this morning. Another one must be somewhere. But thank you to our veterans. Thank you to our veterans' families for the sacrifice that the veterans themselves make. But it also impacts the family. So we certainly want to say thank you that because of your courage and your commitment, we live in a land that we can come and worship freely, travel back and forth to our place of employment, or travel to visit family and friends. And we do indeed thank you. Would you like to stand up, veterans? Veterans family? Veterans? We have two. Come on. Don't be shy. Thank you. Thank you. And as always, thank you for your faithfulness in the financial support of the ministries of this church. There are a lot of them, and without your financial support, many of them would not be possible. So thank you. Again, thank you for the opportunity that we have after this service. Well, actually, on the way in and on the way out, have a cup of coffee. There are some really delicious looking sweet treats this morning if you didn't notice on the way in. So please stop. Get a cup of coffee, a sweet treat on your way to Sunday school. Two adult classes, one for youth and one for children, upstairs. And youth group tonight. Andrea, any comments?
We need a volunteer, an adult volunteer for tonight.
Okay, Andrea is still looking for adult volunteers to help her in
We definitely need one for tonight
from 5 to 7. The pastor is going to be away, so please, if anyone's available, let Andrea know. And today is the last day for the Christmas child. Blair has a couple comments she'd like to make.
This week is collection week, so it's all week. I do want to pack these up into my car today. I would like some able-bodied men to just take them down to the ministry center by the back door after church, and then from there I can get them in my car. But if you forgot today, let me know, and let me know when you'll get it here to the church, and I'll pick it up. I have all week to deliver, so don't say, well, I missed it, you know. So if you have one, just reach out to me and let me know. Thank you.
How many do we have?
At last count, there were 40.
The goal was 50, but 40
right
from last year. So, thank you. Boy, any organization can't survive without meetings. And this week we have a trustee meeting on Tuesday. And then on the 21st, a meeting in church council. There are some dishes out on the coat rack. As you enter the back door, the coat rack to the left, that were dishes that provided food for the harvest dinner. So if you said, oh, I never picked up my dish, I wonder where it's at, take a look. It's a good chance that your dish is there. Thank you to Martha for the fresh flowers that are on the altar this morning in memory of her sister. Any other announcements that need to be? Yes, Les.
I just want to thank everybody that volunteered to be an usher. Pay attention to the schedule, not all the years. Kathy didn't realize on CNOW. And so, but instead of having questions, you could ask me, but thank you.
Okay. Anyone else? Then let us pray together. O God, the Holy Spirit, come to us and among us. Come as the wind and cleanse us. Come as the fire and burn. Come as the dew and refresh us. Convict us, convert us, and consecrate our many hearts and lives to your great good. To thy greater glory, and for this we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. And now, as you are so led and so able, if you would care to stand, but please join me with the praise team as we sing our 201 song, Jesus, Messiah, Joy of the
Lord. Not the Lord this morning, that's the end. Choir. One more line down. Blessed be your name. Thank you.
much to be grateful for. Heard this morning of a devastating fire up on the 4th Avenue. My understanding is that people got out, but the fire departments were there, and so we give thanks for those first responders that were called upon in the middle of the night to stay until early this morning. I'd also like to say thank you to our new AV tech back there. Ken has volunteered to take a turn at that. The past several weeks, I've felt quite challenged. We're starting a new era of the Western faith. And the question to myself is, how was your prayer life? How was your scripture reading? How were your kindness to strangers? Did I go home and review the pastor's sermon last week and take a deeper dive into the scripture? Sadly, most of those answers, well, you didn't do very good, son. But that's what our Western covenant calls us to do, to be mindful and to hold each other accountable. Some days when I don't feel fed, it's not someone else's fault. I failed to go to the table. I failed to go to my knees. I failed to consider the scripture. And so I challenge not only myself, but I challenge each and every one of us. Be more mindful of our prayer life. Be more mindful of our scripture reading. Take a deeper dive into the special scripture that is selected for this morning. Take notes on the pastor's sermon. Reflect on those throughout the week. I know for myself it's easy to walk over out of here and feeling pretty good about what went on. But if you ask me what last week's sermon was about, I couldn't tell you. So my challenge to myself, my challenge to each of you, take that deeper dive and let us pray together. Lord God, what a beautiful morning. We thank you and praise you that we've been able to come to this place to give you our praise and to give you our worship, to be greeted by friends and family, to hear your voice through the handshake or a kiss of a friend, through the songs that we sing, through the scripture that is read, and through the word that is proclaimed. May we hear, and may we be renewed. May we be challenged. May we receive the strength we need to be more faithful disciples. Lord, we come this morning openly and freely because of the sacrifice of many, but especially of our veterans who have fought to protect our freedoms, and not only our freedoms, but the freedoms of many around the world. And so, Lord, we pause to give our thanks for those men and women and for their families, and we ask that you would give them an extra measure of your grace. And Lord, we do pray for those who have been affected by the fire here in town. We also understand there was a significant fire in Corey. It is that time of year. And we do pray that you would be with that family. And we do give you thanks for those first responders. We ask that you would continue to be with those who mourn, those who lay family or friends to rest their final resting place this week. Be with them. And Lord, it's hard to understand the hostilities, the savages of war, particularly that going on in Israel and in Ukraine, but there are other places in this world where men's violence to men, and often case using children and women as a human shield. And for those who have been impacted by the addiction of drugs or alcohol, be with them, Lord, and may they find freedom from their addiction. Lord, as our world leaders who wage war against one another, and as our world leaders who work to seek peace, we ask that you would be with those who seek peace. May that spread across this world. We give thanks and praise for those who have contributed to the many ministries of this church, but in particular for those contributing to Operation Christmas Child. And again, Lord, we continue to pray for Pastor Lee. Be with her and give her the courage, the grace, and the insight to be our leader. And for this entire congregation, be with us, inspire us to be more faithful in our discipleship. Lord, for the things that have remained on our hearts unspoken, we know that you hear them. We lay those things before you again, knowing, believing, with an expectation that you will answer. Lord, now we join our hearts and our voices together as we pray the prayer that you taught your disciples when you said, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on our earth as in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, glory forever." Our musical offering this morning is entitled "Joy in the Morning."
Thank you. tells you how great our praise band is, right? If they've got that for backup singers. Yeah. Yeah. You're allowed to clap in church. We're definitely blessed, and we thank all our musicians. And it's nice when Rosemary recruits whoever comes into her house to come and sing. Did she even give you a choice?
No.
I didn't think so. I didn't think so. You're no no easier to say no to Mrs. O than anybody else, right? Yeah. Oh my. Our scripture for this morning comes from Psalm 78. First 8 verses, hear these words. O my people, hear my teaching. Listen to the words of my mouth. I will open my mouth in parables. I will utter hidden things, things from of old. What we have heard and known, what our fathers have told us, we will not hide them from their children. We will tell the next generation, the praiseworthy deeds of the Lord, and his power and the wonders he has done. He decreed statutes for Jacob and established the law in Israel, which he commanded our forefathers to teach their children, so the next generation would know them, even the children yet to be born, and they in turn would tell their children. Then they would put their trust in God and would not forget his deeds, but would keep his commands. They would not be like their forefathers, a stubborn and rebellious generation, whose hearts were not loyal to God, whose spirits were not faithful to him. May God bless the reading and hearing of these holy words, the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks
be to God. I would invite you to stand as you are able and let us join together in hymn 130. God will take care of you.
Thank you.
before we get into this morning's message. You know, there are 40 of these. 40 of them. 40 plus. Okay, 40 plus. I like the plus. So, plus 10?
I... 43.
No, okay, 43. Plus enough. More than we had last year, so we're happy with that. But it's not just about us feeling good about bringing in 43 boxes filled with good stuff. It's about reaching out to children in need around the world. We've heard a few of the stories. There's plenty more of those online. You can go and check them out. But that's what this represents. It's just a shoebox filled with some goodies. But to a child who gets nothing, usually, this little box means the world. And their world is going to get brightened because of your gifts and your generosity. And in that, they are going to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. They're going to get the salvation message along with some gifts. But they're getting the better gift as part of this ministry. And so we're not just giving toys. We're giving the gift of the gospel of Jesus Christ to kids that might not otherwise hear that message. And as they receive that message, you know they're going to be telling their folks about it. And they're going to be telling other people about it. Because the people that love Jesus, look what they gave me. And they told me about Jesus. And the love that he had for me, that's what they're going to hear. And so as we send these off to wherever they end up, you can track them, I believe. There's a little code on there. You know, we're all high-tech now. But wherever they go, we want to send them not only as an offering, a gift offering, but we want to send them with our prayers. So I would ask that you reach out towards this box or towards the ones over there in the Wesley room as we pray together and dedicate these to the ministry. Almighty and gracious God, we thank you. We thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, and how much he loved each and every one of us. We pray, dear God, that that message of his mighty and powerful love, his saving love, will reach each of the children and their families that receive these shoeboxes with gifts. And as they enjoy their gifts, may they know that they are given in the love of Jesus, and the hope that they will come to know Jesus as their Lord and Savior. And whatever their situation, they will know that they are not alone and that they are loved. Bless each of these boxes, Almighty God, and the child that receives them. Give them safe journey to wherever they go. And through this ministry, may children and families around the world come to know about your Son, Jesus Christ, the greatest gift of all. We thank you. We praise you in his name. And all of God's children said, amen. As we celebrated All Saints Sunday last week, we talked about the great cloud of witnesses that surround us always. Those folks that have gone on and joined the church triumphant, as well as those that are still with us. We all came to know about Jesus because someone told us about him and about his great love for us. They not only told us about Jesus, but they also showed us the difference that following him makes in our lives. We came to believe and trust in Jesus Christ because someone shared their faith with us. They told us about Jesus. And as we shared the sacrament of Holy Communion last week, you were asked to turn to a neighbor and share with them the saints that have touched your lives by sharing their faith. The people that introduced you to Jesus and taught you how to follow him. You talk about those. And you were also challenged in that time to look at your own life and see if you were leaving a legacy of faith. Are you telling people about Jesus the way others told you about Jesus? Are you showing people how to live as a follower of Jesus Christ the way others showed you how to live as a follower of Jesus Christ? Are you sharing the difference faith in Jesus makes in your life each day? I hope and pray that you spent some time with those thoughts during this past week. And we did not talk beforehand, did we? No, so it's a God thing, as was the praise music pick today. Amazing, amazing. So I hope and pray that you spent some time with those thoughts during this last week. I hope you went and I hope you told some of those saints that touched your life. I hope you told them thank you. I hope you told them thank you. There are so many people in our world who don't know the life-changing power of faith. When we place our faith in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, they have an emptiness in their heart that they keep trying to fill. They keep searching for something to give them hope. They keep looking for something or someone to fill that emptiness. We don't need to look very hard to know that the world is telling folks a lot of different things about how to fill that emptiness. The world is telling them lies about how to fill that emptiness. Lies that lead them chasing after fame and fortune to find that fulfillment. Lies that have many using drugs and alcohol and other self-destructive behaviors to numb the pain created by that emptiness. The lies of the world offer nothing more than false. And when the emptiness returns, the heartbreak and the despair only return and continue to grow because the lies of the world don't fill that emptiness. You know, so often I hear folks lamenting about the state of our world. You know, they talk about the violence and the drug use and the broken marriages and all that stuff, and they lament all of that. But what baffles me is that many of those same folks, they have the answer. They have the answer. They know the only solution that will fill the emptiness that so many in our world have. And that solution is Jesus Christ. He is our only hope, our only path to salvation. Living faith in Jesus is life-giving. It's transforming. In fact, it's life itself. We need to testify to the hope that we know in Jesus Christ so that others can have that same hope. So that they can fill that emptiness. We need to witness to the salvation that is only found in Jesus Christ for the benefit of others, but also for ourselves. One, so that we may keep God's commandments, which Jesus told us to go to the ends of the earth, right? Teaching, sharing what he had taught. Yeah. And also, as we share our faith with others, we get to know our faith a little bit. We get to know what we believe and why. And we go a little deeper. We need to witness to our salvation, to the salvation that is only found in Jesus Christ. We need to offer that hope to the world. And we know the world desperately needs it. Our text for today comes from the beginning of the second longest psalm. Anyone know what the longest psalm is? What? Yep. I knew somebody would know. Yeah, 119. This is the second longest. It's attributed to Asaph, one of King David's temple musicians, classified as a wisdom psalm because it was written to instruct God's people that history must not repeat itself. The people of God must learn from the past and teach their children those lessons. And he begins by saying, listen up, I have something important to say. Well, actually it was, you know, give ear to my teaching. But same thing, right? And he then writes what he is going to say is so important that they need to be teaching it to their children. The need to pass the lessons on to the future generations is mentioned more than once just in these 8 verses. And the important message that needs to be shared with all generations is God's continuing faithfulness. Despite the rebellion and the stubbornness of God's people, God continues to be kind and good, to have mercy. If you have ever read about those whining Israelites in the desert for 40 years, God has lots of mercy. Lots of mercy. Despite all that rebellion and stuff, God continues to be kind and good, continues to be faithful to us. And the writer of Psalm 78 reminds his readers of the history of Israel, recalling the nation's continual disobedience to God and reminding them of God's mighty deeds of mercy, of God's blessings that he showered upon them, even those rebellious people. And when the people of Israel obeyed God's commandments, passing them and the stories of God's power and strength on to the younger generations, the nation and the people were blessed. Didn't mean life was always easy, but they had what they needed and were free to worship and follow their God. All around us, we see the problems caused by folks not following God's commandments. Problems caused when God's people only give empty lip service to the faith that they proclaim. We see in our world today what happens when we do not pass down the lessons of the past. When we don't teach our children to put their hope in God. When we don't teach them about the mighty works of God. When we don't teach them to keep God's commandments. The world around us is very full of the effects of all that. If we want people to have true hope, then we need to share our faith in Jesus Christ. We need to share a living faith that goes far deeper than just keeping the commandments or passing on the stories of history. We need to share a living faith from the heart that goes deep, that it encompasses our entire being. That is the faith that blesses people with the hope for all the days of their lives. That living faith will get them through the good, bad, and the ugly days. Living faith in Jesus Christ is the only source of hope that we have for the world in which we live. And it's more than just up here. It's more than just empty lip service. It's got to come from the heart. A changed heart that only happens through Jesus Christ. I want to share with you about a couple of people in my life that had that living faith. That living faith that was more than just, I'm going to go to church on Sunday, I'm going to put my gift in the offering plate, I'll be an usher, I'll be an officer of the church or whatever, I'll be there every week, I can go to Sunday school. But they went beyond that. First one, two weeks ago, was our youth group dad. He passed away with cancer. And I attended the celebration of life for Gary, and anyone that knew him knew that he was a quiet and humble man, and he was a plumber by trade. Worked hard to support his family, and his family had seven kids. Three were his, three were hers, and one was theirs together. And with three older than me, three younger than me, and one in my class, I was right smack dab in the middle of what we're playing. Can't say I remember much about Gary and his family until I was probably in youth group. And for years, I was honestly clueless about that being a blended family, or what we would call today a blended family, because everyone was treated equally. providing a home and support for a family with seven children would have many folks stressed out and probably hesitant about adding any more mouths to feed at the table or any more kids into the mix of chaos that seven children can create. But both Gary and his wife Dixie welcomed with open arms, any of the friends and acquaintances of their kids. They were welcome into their home anytime. Didn't bother them at all, whether it was the cast for the play or some band members or a basketball team, whoever, youth group, we were there quite often. And I remember a time or two when Gary had been out handling a plumbing emergency, and when he came home, it was to a house filled with teens. You figure normally he's got seven, double that. But it didn't bother him. He just always was saying that calm and quiet and welcoming God. And being that half of the youth group was welcomers, we quite often met at their home. And that was always being offered freely by one of the kids. Oh yeah, we'll host it. Never a problem. And I saw that Gary did not just provide his home as a gathering place for all these youth. He also provided himself. Now, he wasn't one to stand up and preach that to everyone. His other brother's a preacher, and his wife was. But he made himself available whenever he could. Whether it was during a youth meeting, a school or community event, church, or in town, Gary would take the time to talk with you, to share himself, to listen to what you had to say. And oftentimes, he was the one to start that conversation, and he was a quiet guy. And I know you're going to find this hard to believe, but to a quiet young lady, trust me, growing up without a father at home, his care, his love that he so freely shared was a very precious gift. He willingly adopted me and so very many others into his family. His unconditional love embraced not only his own kids, but our youth group, those sports teams, those drama casts, the band members that came, and any other kids that showed up. What a blessing to so many teens for so many years, because Gary didn't just stop at the surface. He shared his faith with us and with so many others. And, you know, as a teen, I greatly appreciated Gary and Dixie as parents of our youth group. And as an adult, I came to appreciate Gary's quiet, deep witness as I saw him in a new way as an adult. As a local plumber, he was the go-to guy for plumbing and heating, especially for the longtime residents of Conneautville and Springboro area. And he went above and beyond to take care of the folks, especially the older folks. And when I was serving down in Little's Corners, we had a need at the parsonage for a plumber, and they said, well, we don't really have one, so you know someone you trust? Call. So guess who I called? And that led to Gary bidding the plumbing for the new addition that the church was building, the plumbing and the heating. And his bid was the best one, and so the committee hired him, and after it was all done, when we received the bill, he had tied 10% off our bill. This wasn't his church, but he did that. And he didn't make a big deal over it. He just asked, you know, can you give me a receipt? He just did it. And as I think back, that's what he did. He just always was doing what needed to be done. And when he needed to use words to live out his faith, he did. And I praise God for the countless blessings I received in my life and so many other people because of his living faith. And it wasn't just me. Many shared those same thoughts about Gary that day. And as I was thinking about living faith, Gary Dixie, so many others crossed my mind, but another person was a member of my last congregation, one of the two. And, you know, it's really easy to have living faith and to know its blessings and share that when life is going good, right? That's really easy. We can be joyful and share the blessings of how much we believe in God when life is good. That's easy, right? But when you witness someone living out their faith in the midst of one of the worst days of their life, it is amazing. The state trooper that was killed in the line of duty, was murdered basically in the line of duty, and his parents attended my church, he'd grown up in that church, and to see his parents share their faith and hold on to that faith, even in the midst of that day. I was just moved. I was so blessed to have known them and experienced that. And I praise God for that. And if it hadn't been for their faith being more than just up here, they'd have never gotten through. But their faith was here. In their heart, and it was a faith that they all shared all the time. And so I praise God for Sam and Nancy as they had a living faith. And I received blessings from that as I watched them live that out in the midst of a dark time. That's the faith that touches our hearts. That's the faith that is going to let people see that church is not just a bunch of do's and don'ts. Rules and regulations. You know that. You've heard it. But when we have deep faith that is lived out each and every day, it guides everything you do and say, that's going to touch people's hearts. It's gonna give them hope. And we live in a world that desperately needs to know the hope of Jesus Christ. And if we're not telling them, if we're not showing them, who's gonna do it? Who's gonna do it? We are instructed in God's word to tell about God, to tell the story, to pass those lessons that we have learned in our faith on to our children. We are to pass on the commandments of God to our children and tell them to follow those commandments. Because only when we follow God, only when we surrender our hearts and our lives to Jesus Christ, can we have eternal life. Only when we come to Jesus can that emptiness that, that is in our hearts be filled. And there's a lot of people looking to fill an emptiness. We need to share with them our trust and our faith in Jesus Christ so that they too can have that hope, that they too can feel that emptiness and know that there is a God who loves them and cares about them and died for them. So let's share the blessings of a living faith. Let us make sure that our faith is living and that we are sharing. Because we're called to, but also because we know the power of faith in Jesus Christ. We know the power of God to give us hope, not only for today, but for every day. So may we share with the world blessings of our living faith. Amen?
Amen.
Part of our living faith is our giving to the Lord and to His work. And so at this time, the usher will come forward and receive our morning offering as back into play.
Thank you.
there's a lot of folks that don't. So share the blessing by living out your faith, by telling people about Jesus Christ and how sweet it is to trust in Him. Go into the world and share the good news so that all may come to have hope in Jesus Christ. And all God's children said,
Amen.